This morning for our lesson, we are going to focus primarily on the first five verses. This is such a long section and so much in there. We're going to focus on just those first five verses. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, it's official now. The first two just rolled in, and I'm pretty sure there are going to be many more. 'Tis the season of Christmas cards. By now I have a pretty good idea what kind of cards I get from people. Who's going to send them first? Because those are the people that are always organized and on time. Who's going to send just a picture with a little greeting? Who's going to have a poetic verse? Who's going to have just a small little devotional thought at the beginning of their letter? And who is going to give the highlights of their family for the year? It's great getting those updates, isn't it? Getting updates on what's happening with family and friends, especially if you are separated by time or by mileage or by both. It's good to reconnect and get those updates. Now, as cherished as the giving of a Christmas card tradition is, and I'm not saying get rid of it, is that really what this season is all about? Getting updates from family and friends who are spread abroad. You know, if you go to the first verse of our lesson, notice it doesn't say, update. Update my people, says your God. Tell them everything that's been going on in your life over the past year. Go ahead and check. It's not there. No, the point of this time of year is concentrating on the greatest gift this world has ever been given, and that's the Son of God, Jesus, as our Savior. We have this gift, and God gives it to us freely. And He doesn't want us to take this gift and shove it on the shelf between the knickknacks, letting it collect dust. He doesn't want this gift to be lost somewhere in the back of the closet like that foul tie that your kids gave you when they were younger. He wants you to use that gift. And so this morning, the Lord is going to encourage the prophet Isaiah. He's going to encourage all of us how to use that gift. And He tells us, comfort the Lord's people. Our lesson comes from chapter 40 of Isaiah. If you look at the previous 39 chapters, if you were going to sum up the entire section, that entire 39 chapter section, in one word, it might be judgment. It wasn't a pretty time for the people of Judah. You see, they had prostituted themselves after other gods, forsaking their one true love, forsaking the Lord. God said, I'm not going to put up with that. I'm not going to allow you to give my glory to somebody or something else. And so He tells them, judgment is coming. He looks 100 years down the road and says, captivity is coming for you. Captivity in Babylon, a country that wasn't even a powerhouse at the time. And you're going to spend 70 years of judgment, of punishment, of chastisement in Babylon. That's the setting of those 39 chapters. And then we drop chapter 40 on us. And you can see a total switch. God says, even though you acted like that, look at what He calls them. You are still my people. I am still your God. Even though you acted like that, that hasn't changed the situation that I'm going to be with you. And now even though this judgment was looming, even though captivity was looming, here's this message of comfort through the prophet Isaiah. And you'll note that this message of comfort is actually addressed to the people 100 years down the road, to the people that were living in captivity. And he says, look at your captivity as something that is as good as done. Listen to what he says again, beginning of our lesson. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her hard service has been completed, that her sin has been paid for, and that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all of her sins. Even though there was unfaithfulness, you see, these are my people. And he tells them, there's comfort for you, and really there's a threefold reason why they can be comforted. First, he says, her hard service has been completed. 70 years in captivity, again, still off in the future, but he says, your time, put in time out, has been completed. You're done. Now I'm going to take you back to be in the place you're supposed to be, in the place I've given you. Back to Jerusalem, back to the promised land. Second reason, her sin has been paid for. Not because of animal offerings, not because of outward righteousness, but because of the promise of a Savior. And again, even though Jesus is 700 years down the road, how does God look at that promise of the Savior? It's as good as done, as good as completed. He speaks about it in the past tense. Think about the familiar words that we look at during the season of Lent that come from Isaiah. Remember Isaiah 53, the suffering servant chapter of the Bible? There, Isaiah still uses the past tense. He was pierced for us. He was crushed for us. And so even though it's off in the future, God says it's as good as done. And then the third reason, he says, she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. It's not like when you go through the drive-thru, when you order something and then you realize you forgot most of your money. And so you're digging around in the cup holder looking for spare change, trying to find just enough change to pay the bill. No, God says, you've received double the grace that you needed, double the grace that you required for your sin. Jesus' perfect life, his innocent death, was more than enough to cover your sins and my sins and the world's population and the world's population of all time. You can be comforted, he says. And this is the message you're to speak, Isaiah. Their sins have been paid for, their time is over, and they've received double from the Lord's hand. Have you ever noticed that in most of our worship services, we have a section where we have the confession of sins and the absolution, where we hear those sins are announced forgiven? Well, why is that? I don't know about you, but for me, it seems like it would be a pretty long week or a long time to the next service if we didn't have that. Because how many times did you sin this week? Countless, right? Sins that we know about, sins that we don't know about, sins that truly bother us, sins that we just try to ignore, think of as no big deal. And yet, we have this time to confess those sins. Because those sins bother us. Those sins where we've not used our time and our money in good priority. There are those times when we choose what we want over what God wants. Or what about this? Do you ever go about your Bible reading kind of like you're on your iPod? You know, you hear a tune on your iPod and you don't like it, what do? Flip to the next song, right? You ever go through your Bible that way? You know, I don't like what God says about my sin here and he's convicting me here, so I'll just fast forward to the next song, to the next verse. Hey, this one talks about God's love for me. I'd rather talk about that than talk about God's judgment on me. God gives us the opportunity to confess our sins when it comes to worship. And he's done something for us because, frankly, he knows that we need it. He's put in place called workers in his church to announce that forgiveness to us. You know that you can confess your sins to God at any time, don't you? You can confess your sins in prayer and you know you are forgiven. But you also know that you can come here to worship and you hear that announcement as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all of your sins. In the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins. And what does that do? Just sends those sins away and brings that relief, brings that comfort. You know, the Lord could have come here in this 40th chapter and said directly to the people, be comforted, my people. But he knows that we need to hear it. We need to have it announced to us. And it makes such a difference to us to hear that forgiveness announced, so that those sins are cast away, that they never bother us again. And even though we have broken that love with him often, even though we have done that and separated ourselves from him, he comes to us and says, you are comforted. You are comforted because the same promise of a Savior, that same threefold reason why Israel could be comforted, applies to us. Our hard service is over. No, it's not earning us anything. The sin was paid for by Jesus in his cross. And it was so potent of a sacrifice, so potent of an offering, that we've received double. That our sins have been covered, that they never bother us again. You are comforted because God shows you what he has done for you. And that comfort is now yours. If you think about John the Baptist, when he arrived on the scene, do you remember the message he was told to preach? Go back to verse 1. Comfort the people, right? And yet, if you were listening to John's message, you might wonder about it. Listen again. Isaiah writes, a voice of one calling in the desert, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the wilderness a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill made low, and the rough ground shall become level. The rugged place is a plain, and the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all mankind together will see it. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Think about what John was told to say. Bring comfort to the people. And do you remember what his message was? Repent. Does that sound like comfort to you? There's comfort there in that they were to acknowledge their sin. They were to acknowledge their selfishness. They were to acknowledge their unrighteousness before God, so that nothing got in the way. Because how is that good news of Jesus supposed to ring true if they don't first acknowledge their sin? And so this call for repentance was to get them ready for when Jesus came on the scene to say, I am here as your Savior. And it didn't ring empty. When you heard those verses, didn't it sound like there's a whole lot of road construction going on? Leveling out the high places, filling in the empty spots? Well, what is it? In John's day, he's saying, get rid of anything that is an obstruction. Get rid of your self-righteousness. Get rid of your vanity. Get rid of your pride, your greed. Make way for the Lord Jesus to come. Well, how do we do that today? Well, do you have any bumps in the road this Christmas season for you? Now, I'm not talking about your plans for Christmas are kind of in limbo because you don't know about travel plans and who's going to be where and who's going to make what and all those sorts of things. I'm not talking about bumps in the road or hiccups as far as what do I get this person for Christmas. I'm talking about what is the obstruction that's in your way when it comes to God's comfort. Is it the pothole of ingratitude? Or is it that mountain of greed? Is it that sinkhole of selfishness? Or that rugged place of self-righteousness? Well, God says to us, smooth those things out. Smooth those things out by repentance. Martin Luther described us as being nothing more than beggars in this world. We have nothing to offer God except our sin and to confess it to him. You've seen those people on the side of the road at the exit and entrance ramps holding the sign saying, "We'll work for food." He wants us to hold a different side. We'll give thanks for salvation. We'll give thanks because of what the Lord has done. And now he comes to us and says, "You have been shown exactly what I've done for you. Now here's what you can do for me. Here's what you can do for me in return." He wants us to live our lives. He wants us to serve him. He wants us to be comforted by his word as we use his word, as we hear it, we celebrate the Lord's Supper together. But he says also, "I want you to comfort as you have been comforted." I want you to use that word, that forgiveness, and give it to other people. I want you to speak tenderly to others. But in speaking tenderly, that doesn't mean glossing over sin. It means calling sin for what it is. If somebody is despising the Word of God, it's telling them you are despising it. If somebody is not living in according to God's will, it's saying something about it. But what are you doing? You're preparing that heart, aren't you? You're helping that person get that obstacle, that obstruction out of the way, so that they can hear the message of Jesus as their Savior. So they can have that heart healed, and they can be comforted by the Word of God. You know, updates are great. It's good to find out about people, good to find out what's going on. But if somebody didn't get your Christmas letter this year, would it really kill them? Probably not. But you have a whole lot of people who haven't received the update that a Savior has been born, who is Christ the Lord. You have a whole lot of people who haven't received that update, and so they don't have the comfort that you have. Don't let anything be an obstruction in your way this holiday season, this Christmas season. Come before the Lord in repentance and be assured that your sins are forgiven. But then also be equipped so that you can share that same comfort with others. To prepare their hearts, and yes, it means making them uncomfortable at first because of their sin, but giving them the soothing balm of the gospel that Jesus has been born for them. He is Christ the Lord. Amen. Please rise.